Gita, 6th chapter, we have been discussing yoga. We discussed what are the preparatory things needed for the practice of yoga, who can be a yogi and how yoga is practiced, etc. Now we start verse number 24 and proceed from here. And this particular part, we shall be dealing with certain requirements of the mind for the practice of yoga. And number two, what is the ultimate result of yoga? See, normally you will find that there are people who are practicing yoga for mental health and physical health and this and that. As we mentioned in the previous talks, that those things are related to concentration. When we talk of meditation, when we talk of yoga, the result is entirely different. The aim is entirely different. You don't do yoga just for your concentration, you don't do it for your mental well-being and physical well-being, etc. It's about knowing the supreme reality. Yoga is about knowing the supreme reality. Yoga is about knowing your true nature. So there are just two, three verses which further elaborate the requirements of that supreme yoga. Sankalpa pravan kamans tektva sarvana sheshatah mansai vindriya gramang viniyamya samantatah. See, quite often people think that if you practice yoga, you will be achieving this goal and you will be achieving that goal. Interestingly, yoga says just the reverse. It says that if you want to practice the real yoga, if you want to do real yoga, if yoga is the aim and goal of your life, then the first thing is that every ambition and every desire, every idea from the mind has to go away first. That's why yoga is not meant for everybody. Whatever desires you might have, it says, Sankalpa Pravan Kaman. Whatever goal you may have in life, whatever aim, ambition and pursuits that you might have in life, you have to first give it up. Mind has to become absolutely clear. Mind has to become completely desireless. It shouldn't even have an iota of desire left. So, nothing, no desire should arise in your mind. Mind it, we are not discussing concentration. We are not discussing worldly well-being. We are discussing the knowledge of supreme reality. Gita is a scripture. Goal of every scripture is to take you to God. Nothing less than that. If at all it talks about well-being in the world, it is just a casual reference. That cannot be the goal. For that you have to go and study science, you have to study economics, you have to study other subjects. Scriptures are not meant for that. It says, Mansai Vindriya Gramang Viniyamya Samantata. Whatever desires you have in your mind, whatever goals you may set in life, everything has to go away. Mind has to become absolutely free. And says, Mansai Vindriya Gramang. Indriya Gram. Gram basically means village. And it means the totality. The senses that are active in your mind, they need to be gathered in totality and need to be thrown away. Mind cannot be allowed any kind of disturbance, inner or external. We discussed earlier that our five senses keep on bringing inputs to the mind. And then we have our own inputs, inner inputs, coming from the dream state, coming from memories, etc. Everything has to be controlled completely. Then only mind becomes free. It's something like, you know, imagine you want to take a car on a long drive and you need to go fast. So first is that you fine-tune its engines and you remove the extra baggage, extra load that's on it. Once you have cleared everything, then it's ready for a real fast drive. Your mind is now about to move towards God. mind needs to be cleaned of everything. It needs to be cleared of everything. So can you achieve it in a day? No, you cannot. Can anybody achieve it in a day? No, nobody can. How is it done? Very slowly. Very slowly and very softly. Verse number 25 says, Shanai Shanai Ruparmed Buddhya Dhriti Grihitaya. You need to control your intellect, the finer faculties of your mind. See what happens. Actually, we are discussing Gita and all these meditation, concentration, etc. We are discussing based on Gita. And Gita does not specialize in this. Raja Yoga actually specializes in these things. Just to say in brief, it says that mind has different faculties. And its most ordinary faculties, when it keeps on vacillating, is it correct, is it right, it is wrong, you know, things like that. And its highest faculties, when it is determined. Well, it is this, I know this is to be true. Now, when mind is vacillating, when it's not able to decide things properly, indecisive, we call it mind, mana. And when it becomes decisive, we call it buddhi, intellect. So man and buddhi, these are two different things as far as yoga is concerned. Under our normal conversation, we treat mind same as man and also as intellect, buddhi. But once you get into technicalities, things become different. See, under normal conditions, we would say engine. But if you go to an engineer, for them, aircraft engine is different, and railway engine is different, and petrol engine is different, diesel engine is different, just like that. Once you go to the technician of the mind, he will say that man is different, chitta is different, ankar is different, buddhi is different. They all become different. So he says that mind, the decisive faculty of the mind, that actually regulates everything. And that is the clutch. It catches anything. Buddhi is that clutch. It catches. And what does it do? It catches the indecisive mind. And slowly, it pulls the mind out of its indecisiveness. It pulls it out of its tendency to run after worldly pleasures. And it pulls the mind out of the ordinary worldly goals. So he says, shanai shanai. It cannot be done in a day. Nobody can practice meditation in a day. It takes a long time, not years. It takes births. Very slowly, you go on. You go on building your tendencies over the years, over many births. Shanai shanai uparved buddhya dhriti grihitaya. You have to be persistent about it. Do not expect quick results. You have to go, keep on working on it. It's just like as in bodybuilding. You keep on working and working. When you have to go to a gym, you cannot say that you can do it in a day. See, any work requires perseverance. Unless you keep working persistently for a very long time on some project, do not expect success. See, there are cases. For example, you might be knowing of Harper Lee, who wrote To Kill a Mockingbird. She has written only one book in her life, and she is famous. That's a very unusual thing. Because usually, for any writer to succeed, he or she has to write many books. Some of them will be great, some of them will be ordinary. See, even as far as Shakespeare is concerned, they say that less than 40% of his works are truly great, and some of them are very ordinary. Now, if you look at the works of any great poet, you will see that they have written ordinary things, good things, and really great things. It's the persistence that counts. In yoga also, it's the persistence that it counts. You have to keep on doing, just hold on. And what do you do? Atma sangstham manah kritva na kinchidapi chintayet. You need to constantly think on this, that Atman alone exists. Atman alone has become everything. Whatever you see all around, the world that you see, people that you see, the objects of desire that you see, everything is actually Atman. That means there is gold and there is jewelry. So when you look at the earrings and necklace and other kinds of jewelry, you should know that, well, everything is gold. Whatever we see all around us, they are all manifestations of Atman only. We love certain things, we do not love certain other things. We dislike certain other things. Things we like to run towards them. Things we do not like, we want to move away from them. And it's going towards certain things, moving away from certain things. This is life. What else is there in life? Life is movement. Life is basically a movement. What movement? You move towards things you like and you move away from things you don't like. Now, once you know that everything is Atman, why would you be worrying about likes and dislikes? A lady goes to a jewelry shop and there she decides that she would have a necklace, she would have an earring, you know, things like that. The person who wants to purchase gold, he won't be bothered about those things. He'll say, that, well, I'm interested only in the weight of gold. A person who wants the world, that person will go on looking for the likes, dislikes, objects of desires, etc. Person who wants to realize God, person who wants to know supreme reality will not be bothered about these things. Your mind gets disturbed. Why? Because you want to go near your beloved. You want to go near the objects that you like. But once you know that everything is Atman, why would you be running towards anything? Now this cannot be practiced in a day. It requires persistence. You need to keep on working on it. And every time your mind wavers, every time you want to run towards something, every time you want to run away from certain things, you have to remind that mind it. This is also manifestation of Atman. With this thought, you need to settle yourself in yourself persistently for a very long time. So it says that yato yato nishcharati manaschanchalam ostiram tatastato niyamyestat atmaneva vashamnayat. It is in the nature of mind to stay disturbed. It's in the nature of mind. The way you cannot control a child. If you look at a child who is maybe 4 years or 5 years old, unless the baby is sleeping or is ill, that baby will continuously be talking, chatting and running around. Mind is just like that. Mind has a tendency to stay continuously in an agitated state. Mind has to be active and mind requires activity to stay calm. It's like a bicycle that falls down if you make it stand. Bicycle has dynamic equilibrium. Bicycle can stand erect only when it's moving. Just let it stand and it will fall down. Mind will collapse if it doesn't get activity. So it is in the nature of mind to stay disturbed. Now you are trying to make it calm. It's a very difficult thing. And as we have been practicing, as we have been discussing, slowly you have to bring it under control. And as the mind comes under control, it starts becoming calm. Slowly it becomes calm. And says that whenever mind becomes disturbed because of the objects of pleasure and objects of hatred or dislike, you need to think continuously why I want to run towards it. Then you say, I want to run towards it because I like it. I want to stay away from this thing because I hate it. Then you need to think that mind it. Everything is manifestation of God only. Everything is manifestation of Atman only, or everything is creation of God only. I don't need it. That's a different thing. I need it. For example, even the greatest of yogi needs food. That's a different issue. But to think that I need this kind of special food and, you know, those special feasts that you get in a hotel. So first you need to go to a hotel and order that feast and you need to have money for that. And for that you need to earn money. It goes on. The cycle goes on. All this has to stop. You need food so that your belly is full. You get energy. You can meditate. And just find the simplest thing that can fill up your belly. If you keep on running after the pleasurable items of food, then you know that you are heading for trouble. So he says, even when your mind becomes slightly disturbed, remind it again and bring it back. Now, once mind learns to get settled, what happens to you? So, next few verses talk about the benefits of yoga. What exactly you gain? What exactly you gain when your mind is controlled? When your mind is totally under control? Like people talk about dharma jivan, adhyatmik jivan, spiritual life. People talk about religious life. How do you gain if you have a religious life? Basically, when you have a religious life, you are practicing yoga. And once you practice yoga, your mind is totally under control. And if your mind is totally under control, then what happens? Verse number 27, it begins, Prashant manasam yenam yoginam sukham uttamam upaiti shantarasam brahma bhutam akalmasham. Once your mind is calm, the active nature of mind calms down. It is no more active. And once it stops being active, it realizes that God alone exists. It realizes that Brahman alone exists. It realizes that Atman alone exists. And once it realizes, no, not theoretical. See, till when we were discussing the practice, it was theoretical. You need to remind yourself repeatedly that all this is Atman. And now, once your mind has become calm, you actually see it. Once you actually see it, you reach the state of supreme bliss from which nothing can take you away. This is known as God realization. The devotees of Vishnu will say that, getting vision of Vishnu. Those who worship Shiva will say that, there's vision of getting Shiva. How do you get the vision of Shiva? How do you get the vision of Vishnu? By making your mind calm. When you say that, whatever is manifestation of Atman. Once your mind becomes calm, you see that pure consciousness as everything. And if you have been a worshipper of Shiva, then you see everything as Shiva. The good, the bad, the ugly, the lovable, whatever is there, you see as Shiva. And once your mind becomes completely calm, what do you see? You see only Lord Shiva and Shiva and Shiva, nothing else. Just imagine you are somewhere near North Pole or South Pole. Water has frozen and everything is now ice. It has different kind of shape. And you are continuously thinking that essentially it's all water. And suddenly one fine morning you find that whole thing has become water. Now there is no thinking, no contemplation, no reasoning. You are seeing that it's all water. And after that, if it gets frozen again, even then, nothing will change for you. You will know that ultimately it's all water. Even then you will have the use of ice and you will have the use of water, but you will know that, well, it's all water. That's the difference between theoretical understanding and actual realization. Upaiti shantarasam brahma bhutam akalmasham. Such persons become absolutely pure. There is no tinge of activity in their mind. And because there is no activity left in their mind, neither they run towards something, nor they run away from something. Their mind becomes absolutely calm, and so they enjoy the bliss of Atman, the supreme bliss. Yunjanevam sadatmanam yogi vigata kalmashah sukhena brahma sansparsam atyantam sukham asnute. Ashnute says, now that all the obstacles of a yogi is gone away, he has overcome everything. And so his mind is continuously indrawn. His mind is all the time established in Brahman. His mind is all the time established in Atman. So he enjoys that supreme bliss which cannot be compared with anything in this world, because it is unending, it's infinite. While discussing fifth chapter, we were discussing that whenever there is pleasure, adyantavantah, it has a beginning, it's an end. You enjoy something, there is a beginning, there is an end to it. But when it comes to the bliss born of atmajnan, it is anant. It can never end because it's infinite. And further, what happens? Your perception towards the world changes. Verse number 29 says, Sarva bhutstham atmanam, sarva bhutani chatmani, ikshate yoga yuktatma, sarvatra samadarshanam. This is something that Indian philosophy, Hindu religion, Hindu spiritual philosophy keep discussing that. If you attain spiritual wisdom, you will see oneness everywhere. You will say that. You are talking about oneness. And just look at the immense number of dividing factors that are there in the Hindu society. You have caste system, you have varna system, and you have subcaste, and you have male, female, there are division. And yet, open any spiritual book of the Hindus, be it Ramayana, be it Mahabharata, be it Veda, be it Upanishads, be it Gita, it will always be talking about the ultimate reality as being one and only one. Not God as one. Everything has a unified existence. So how come there are so many divisions? Because see what happens. What do these people say that the real role of religion is in the field of spirituality. Religion and society, these are two different things. Society divides, religion unifies. The real goal of Hindu religion is to make people unite. Society keeps on dividing. Society keeps on creating the hierarchy. But religion repeatedly tells, look, that's wrong. In the ultimate analysis, you alone exist. In the ultimate analysis, there is no division. In the ultimate analysis, there is no I and you. So these two forces, the divisiveness and unification, keeps running in Hindu religion. I mean, you can do nothing about it. Because somehow religion and society, they are so intermingled in Hindu religion that when you catch hold of religion, it moves over to the society. When you catch the society, it moves over to the religion. And that's why we have so many scriptures. Because the great sages, they come and repeatedly tell that your perception about religion is wrong. What you talk about Brahman, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Sudra, this is all wrong. There is no such division. Atman alone exists. Brahman alone exists. God alone exists. We listen to them. We appreciate them. We clap. We appreciate. And we go back to the society and we practice that same divisiveness. And we can do nothing. This is how the life goes on. So he says, Sarvutstam Atmanam Sarvabhutani Chatmani. So, the person now sees that, starting from the blade of grass to Brahma, the highest God, it's all one single thing. So then he sees that the entire universe, everything exists within him. And he alone exists in everybody else. A person who has realized Atman, a person who is a Brahmagyani, he will see that I have become all of you. Everything has come out of me. I alone exist. I am in all of you. And all of you are within me. When people talk about God realization, when people talk about seeing God in whatever religion, usually they mean to have some vision of God where they forget the world. Yeah, that's wonderful. Hindu religion goes one step beyond. It says that, no, it's not about seeing God in isolation to the world. It's about seeing the world as manifestation of God, as God Himself. That's the fundamental difference. It says, what happens then? Yomang pashyati sarvatra sarvam cha mai pashyati tasyaham na pranashyami sacha mena pranashyati. Shri Krishna is telling that a person who has reached this level, a person who has reached the highest level of yoga, one who has calmed his mind totally, and one who is established in the divine oneness of existence, such a person never forgets me, and I never forget such a person. Pranashyati means to destroy, nash. But actually it means that he doesn't let go of me at any point of time. That means I am ever present, ever existent for such a person. And he is one with me. Because a person who has calmed his mind, a person who has reached the highest level of realization, for him, nothing exists other than God. And for God also, nothing exists other than God. And that's why such a devotee is the soul of God. And as a person can never go out of himself, you can never forget yourself. You can never get away from you yourself. Nobody can move away from oneself. How you may try, whatever you may try, you can never jump out of yourself. You will always be you. God will always be God. And such a yogi who has attained that oneness, he is one with God. So God can never, not even for a microsecond, forget such a person, can let go of such a person. No, and vice versa, such a person can never ever forget God. The divine oneness reaches that level. Sarvabhut sitang yomang bhajati ekatvam asthita sarvatha vartmanopi samai vartate. Such a person, he is ever established in me. Whatever he may do, whatever good he may be doing, whatever bad he might be doing. When he is talking about religion, he is established in God. When he is talking about the trivialities of the world, even then he is established in God. He never moves away from God. His mind, under every condition, like if you just look at, if you chance to read New Testament, the Bible, you will see that whatever Jesus might be doing, his mind was always on God. If you read Sri Ramakrishna, you will find that even when he was talking about trivial things, in a second you will see that his mind is back to God. So there is never ever a situation, never ever a point of time when they are away from God. And the ultimate of Vedanta comes when it says, Atmopamyin sarvatra samang pasyati yojuna sukam va yadiva dukkam sa yogi parmo matah. So then this such a yogi starts seeing the entire world as himself. And then he realizes that the way I get happy by certain things, others also get happy by those very things. And the way I get upset about certain things, others also get upset about other things. See, there's a very famous story, I think I mentioned that in the world of religions, that there was a religious preacher and he was asked by a king, Jewish, tell me in one sentence, tell me about religion. Standing on your one leg, says, do not do unto others what you do not want to be done to yourself. This is whole of religion. Apparently this is ethics, but no, this is not ethics. Here we are discussing from Gita, it says that once you know that you alone have become everything, for example, mother knows that her child is she herself. Any child is extension of mom. Any child is not extension of papa. Any child is extension of mom. The baby is part of mom's body. And mom knows that the way she likes certain things, the baby also likes. If Mother can get hurt, baby can also get hurt. If mom can feel pain, the baby also feels pain, in the sense that the cold affects mom and cold affects the baby also. Because they are unified. In the world you find that the rich never care for the poor, the powerful never care for the powerless. They say that I need everything and I don't care whether you live or not. A mom will never think like that. If during chilly nights, winter nights, if mom starts feeling cold, she will get worried that, oh my God, baby also must be feeling cold. So she runs and puts some blanket, some quilt over that baby. Just like that, a Brahmagyani, a man who is really established in yoga, he knows that this world is me. What hurts me, hurts him too. What appeals to me, appeals to them also. So, I must not hurt anybody. And that's how they get established completely in non-violence. They will never hurt anybody physically, verbally, emotionally, mentally, no way. Initially it begins theoretically. Then they see the oneness as divine realization, and from there finally it gets down to practical level. Now when we talk about Buddha priest non-violence, when we talk about Mahavirjan preaching non-violence, it's not that every religion has to preach non-violence. Any religion that talks about oneness, divine oneness, or everybody being children of God, that religion can never preach violence. If there is violence in the name of religion, if there is a violence in the name of God or in particular sect, there is something seriously wrong with that religion. Because when you look at Gita, it says, it's a very simple thing. You have a mind, practice yoga and your mind will become calm. Once your mind becomes calm, what do you see? You see existence of God. You see that God is real. You see that Supreme Consciousness is real. And then you realize, this is the first. Second is, then you realize that Supreme Consciousness alone has become everything. Third, you realize that you are that Supreme Consciousness, and hence, you alone have become this entire world. This entire world exists in you, and you exist in the entire world. And hence, you will never hurt anybody ever. And as we cross in the fifth chapter, Sarvabhuta Hidayrata, a yogi, such a yogi will always be trying to do good to every being, irrespective of what creature it is. Starting from an ant to the highest angels, such a yogi will always be devoted to doing good to every being, living or dead. This is the ultimate of yoga. And this is what you get when you begin, like a startup. It's a very small thing. The egg hatches, it grows, and it grows, and it grows. And finally it grows and you realize that you alone have become everything. Nothing else exists outside you. And then you don't hurt anybody. You start caring for the entire world. Because the entire world exists within you. Well, that's the goal of yoga. With this we end here. Thank you.